The wedding was wonderful. At Westminster Abbey, much to Mama's delight. Me in an amazing white dress, and my little sisters, Rhoda and Violet, as bridesmaids. And Reggie looking so strong and handsome in a dress suit. Oh yes, I haven't mentioned the children before, have I? Rhoda was 7 years younger than I, and Violet 12. I had two younger brothers as well. We were a large family. Then the honeymoon. First, a wonderful 3 weeks at a house lent to us by one of Reggie's relations. We played at calling each other Mr. and Mrs. Hargreaves and giggling at the thought of it. And we walked through their wonderful grounds and gazed at the flowers in their ornamental garden. It was lovely. Then, a few months later, Reggie and I went travelling in Spain. I enjoyed it, but Reggie didn't. He could never really forgive foreigners for not speaking English. Or if they could speak English, he couldn't forgive them for not being English. Poor Reggie, that was one of his weaknesses. So, I had arrived in Lyndhurst, and Lyndhurst was to be my main home for almost 50 years. A very different place it was then. Much smaller, with far fewer people, and no school, and no opportunities for young people to expand their horizons. Reggie and I were leaders in the good changes that happened to Lyndhurst over those years. Oh, I know that Cuffnell's is long gone, but the effect we had on Lyndhurst is still there to be seen, and it seems to me that it is all to the good. St. Michael's Church here had recently been rebuilt by public subscription, and that was a splendid start. Reggie and I carried on from there. We were instrumental in building the schools, both here in Lyndhurst and in Emery Down. Reggie was keen on sport and healthy exercise, and it's thanks to him there's a cricket pitch up at Swan Green. He encouraged the owner of Northerwood to build it. We had our own at Cuffnell's, of course. Reggie started the Boy Scout troop and the cricket club, and became a magistrate, of course, and was something big in the Conservative Club. And there were always constant appeals for worthy causes.
Mrs. Hargreaves, we'd be so grateful if you and your husband could assist in the building of a staff house for the school at Lyndhurst.
And just as needy of children at Emery Down.
And a very worthy cause is the mission to the Zulus.
I started up a branch of the Women's Institute in Emery Down. It was expected of us that we should do such things, and we always tried to do our duty. And I always liked to improve the lot of the women of the forest.
And the mission to the Zulus.
And
the
Girl Guides were very worthy cause.
And so it went on. We did our best to stop Lyndhurst becoming too common and too overrun with tourists. There was talk of a railway line being extended up to Lyndhurst, and they even started building a railway station at the bottom of the high street. It's a car showroom now. Reggie and I, and most of the better class people, were against that, and in the end it did not happen. We later fought against the introduction of electricity to the village. I think perhaps we were wrong. So when you look around Lyndhurst today, you can still see signs of the many good things that Reggie and I helped to start. But life isn't all good causes and charity work. There were times when it seemed as if it was, I must confess.
Mrs. Hargreaves, you just spare the time, you and your husband, to give us a little help with the...
Enough, enough. Like I said, life isn't all about supporting good causes. Most of my life, most of my fun was with my family, with Reggie, with my sisters and brothers who were still mostly at Oxford, and later, of course, with the children. Now, I've said that I fell in love with Cuffnell's right from the start, and it's true. But Cuffnell's was the first house of my own, and I couldn't help being a bit apprehensive. Do you remember those bits in the Alice books where she's shut out in front of a huge door and doesn't know how to get in? Dodgson captured them so well. I remember feeling that as a child, and I felt just a little of it moving into Cuffnell's.
The footman was sitting on the ground near the door, staring stupidly up into the sky. Alice went timidly up to the door and knocked.
"There's no sort of use in knocking," said the footman, "and that for two reasons. First, because I'm on the same side of the door as you are, and secondly, because they're making such a noise inside no one could possibly hear you." And certainly there was a most extraordinary noise going on within.
"Please then," said Alice, "how am I to get in?"
"There might be some sense in your knocking," the footman went on without attending to her, "if we had the door between us. For instance, if you were inside, you might knock and I could let you out, you know."
He was looking up into the sky all the time he was speaking, and this, Alice thought, was decidedly uncivil. "But perhaps he can't help it," she said to herself. "His eyes are so very nearly at the top of his head." "But at any rate, he might answer questions." "How am I to get in?" she repeated aloud.
"Oh, I shall sit here," the footman remarked, "till tomorrow."
And at this moment, the door of the house opened and a large plate came skimming out, straight at the footman's head. It just grazed his nose and broke to pieces against one of the trees behind him.
"All the next day, maybe,"
the footman continued in the same tone, exactly as if nothing had happened.
"How am I to get in?" asked Alice again in a louder tone.
"Oh, you're going to get in at all," said the footman. "That is the first question, you know."
It was, no doubt, only Alice did not like to be told so. "It's really dreadful," she muttered to herself, "the way all creatures argue. It's enough to drive one crazy." The footman seemed to think this a good opportunity for repeating his remark, with variations.
"I shall sit here," he said, "on and off, for days and days."
"But what am I to do?" said Alice.
"Anything you like," said the footman, and began whistling.
Well, going into Cuffnell's for the first time did bring a few butterflies to my stomach, but my fears proved groundless. By early 1881, we were installed at Cuffnell's and starting our new life. Meanwhile, the world had moved on, of course. Gladstone was Prime Minister, and there was much talk of Irish problems and reform in education. But Reggie and I were more interested in starting our new life in Lyndhurst. I really loved Cuffnell's. It was in a beautiful spot and had some amazing rooms in it. The main bedroom had been slept in by George III lots of times, and it had gold-plated taps in the hand basin. And there was a room decorated with huge Italian murals when the painters had been specially brought over from Italy. Oh, and those were such happy times. The forest was at its most beautiful during the first few months, and the excitement of decorating Cuffnell's to our taste was intoxicating. We were busy, but we had so much fun. I remember Reggie waltzing me round underneath the Italian murals to imaginary music, and we had such times playing at being royalty in the bedroom where kings had slept and turning on and off our gold-plated taps.